this climate change, now they are becoming more severe, they're becoming more aggravated. Drought in some areas become so dry. In other areas, floodings are happening that we have never seen them before. In others, flooding are becoming more frequent. Rainfall is becoming erratic, it either comes too early or too late. And when it comes, it is too heavy. In some areas, especially in coastal areas, we see the sea level rise is causing a movement of salinity inland, and we are losing a lot of land. A typical example in tropical deltas has happened this year in South Vietnam and also in Bangladesh. And with that, it results in serious reduction in rice productivity. And the consequences of that is people who are living in these less favorable areas are always impacted with low productivity because their system is not productive due to drought or due to flooding or due to salinity. And when climate change makes this more aggravated, their food security is impacted and they went deep into poverty. So what we are doing at IRRI, when IRRI started in the 1960s, the first step is to increase productivity in favorable areas. And that is basically the irrigated areas where we come with the first green revolution rice, which is short varieties that can produce more whenever you give it more nutrients and it will not fall off, it will not lodge. But unfortunately, these varieties have lost all the tolerances that can allow them to survive in less favorable areas, especially in drought areas, in salt-affected areas, and in flood-affected areas. So farmers in these areas did not benefit from this first green revolution. In the 70s, when IRRI realized this, we started working on our gene bank to try to get strains of rice that can tolerate this condition and then transfer that tolerance into new high-yielding varieties like the Green Revolution varieties, but it takes a long time from the 70s until the 90s. We are not able to produce varieties, but with the advent, with the coming of new molecular and genomic tools, now we are able to do that. We have got the mechanisms and genes that can help crops of rice to survive these less favorable areas. And I just want to show one example is the development of flood-tolerant varieties with the transfer of a single gene, we call it sub-1 or submergence tolerance 1. What happened with that gene? It protects the plant underwater if it is completely flooded for up to 2 weeks, sometimes up to 18 days. And this is exactly what happened in flood-affected areas where flash floods come in, cover the crop for about 10 to 12 days or 14 days, and then the water recedes. And all our varieties die under these conditions. And you can see that here in the field. This is a typical example of varieties. If you look at this first variety, it's called Tehrang sub-1. Tehrang variety, it is actually a famous variety from Indonesia. It's high-yielding, good quality, but sensitive to flooding. When we transfer sub-1 into it, it becomes flood-tolerant, and now we are able to release it in many countries in South Asia, in India, in Bangladesh, in Nepal, and also in Indonesia. You can see when it's flooded for about 18 days here in this field, the version with sub-1 completely survive and produce good yield. The one without sub-1 vanish completely. So this is a real typical solution for farmers when flooding happens. So they are now assured that even with flooding, they will have something out, they will have good production. And we can see that causing a lot of social change in farmers in flood-affected areas where once they have secured their food, they can think of other alternatives. You see increasing their income by diversifying their options. They are taking better care of their crop right now because they know it will produce at the end. So they are putting more input and more care for their crop. They are getting more and more credit for their farm operations. And also they are diversifying their crops now. So besides rice, they are producing other crops. And migration, we see also, is decreasing to some extent. And the good thing also, we have salt tolerant varieties. We have more than 30 salt tolerant varieties now released all over the Asian countries and also in Africa. The good thing about these varieties is if there is no stress, the yield is as high as irrigated varieties. Very good yield, 6 to 7 tons easily. But When stress happens, say flooding, or if there is incidence of drought, of salinity suddenly become high during the season, the farmers still can get reasonable yield, more than 60% of the yield they can get, while from their when there is no flood or when there is no stress, while in the past they can normally get zero, and that would be a disastrous year for them. So these coping strategies now are really helping us to adapt to climate change and make sure that the farmers will be able to secure their food supply even in the face of climate change.